हेलो, गुड मॉर्निंग. गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन. मैं ऑडिबल?
यस सर, यू आर ऑडिबल, परफेक्टली ऑडिबल.
थैंक यू ऑल द मेंबर्स. थैंक यू रिस्पेक्टेड स्पीकर्स गौरव सर एंड रिचा मैम फॉर जॉइनिंग इन ऑन दिस संडे मॉर्निंग. So today we have scheduled a VCM on e-invoicing. So before starting with the VCM, I would like to give a short introduction for our respected speakers. So CA Richa Jain ma'am, she is a qualified chartered accountant with demonstrated history of working in various sectors like audit, consultancy, hospitality, and many more. She is qualified in November 2014 batch, and she is holding a post-qualification experience of 5 years. Also, she has experience on indirect taxes, and currently she is holding a position of manager with AMRG and Associates. That's a firm based at Delhi. She is a strong administrative professional, graduated from Delhi University in BCom. So welcome, Richa ma'am. Thank you for accepting our invitation for this VCM today. Moving ahead, I would like to give a short description for Gaurav Mohan sir. Respected sir is a CEO of AMRG and Associates and he is a B.Tech from IIT Delhi and he is an MBA from IIM Indore. He is currently working with multinational, like rich experience of multinational companies like Mahindra and SKP Business Consulting. After gaining rich experience, he joined the family profession, which is associated like with AMRG and Associates, and he's a mentor at present firm where he's helping to train and streamlining of internal management of organization. His rich corporate experience had enabled seamless handling of the management of the organization. In the firm, he's managing activities like audit, taxation, and GST consultancy for a number of clients. So with this short description, I would welcome Mohan sir and Richa ma'am, and thank you for accepting an invitation for on behalf of Chamber Study Circle, ma'am and sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for the good morning, everyone. Hope everyone is in sound. First of all, I would like to thank all of you to join us on Sunday morning. So my name is CA Richa Jain. I'm associated as a manager in AMRG and Associates. Our firm is established in 1984. Since then, we are the corporate clients. We are firm provides full range of services from business advisories, financials, and so on. We generally excel in GST. In today's seminar, I would like to shine our lights for this meeting and the technical aspects of the e-invoicing. The legal aspects would be discussed. Then I would like to give the charge to Mr. Gaurav Mohan, who is the CEO of the organization, to discuss about the technical and other aspects of e-invoicing. As we all know that the e-invoicing has become international from first of all, classes of taxpayers. But before going into the e-invoicing, I would like to give a brief, I would like to give a brief description about the history of the e-invoicing across the world. Okay, e-invoicing. The e-invoicing emerges. It's emerges from the concept of EDI. Well, now what is EDI? So basically, EDI is an electronic data interchange. As the name suggests, EDI helps to serve. It provides a standardized format and helps the company to send the information electronically, as thus ensure the reliable transferability. So the e-invoicing also works on the same concept. It also automates the process of generation of e-invoicing. Now, according to the survey that has been conducted, GSX. So GSX is a subsidiary of Canadian company. So a survey has been conducted by GSX in 2013. According to that, the respondents are now very much well-versed with the true benefits of e-invoicing. And thus, the acceptance of e-invoicing among the people has been increased from 73%, which was 59% in 2012. Similarly, the resistance has been decreased from 46% in 2012. So various similarly, US Treasury estimates through the implementation of e-invoicing, we can ensure the cost reduction of up to 50%, which will be equivalent to the $450 million annually. As we know, the e-invoicing concept has been introduced in India from the 1st October 2020. But the same has been utilized throughout the world by many of the more than 100 countries. So, however, the applicability of invoicing may vary from country to country. So, like in Mexico, it is mandatory for business to business and business to government transactions. In Spain, it is used only for the suppliers that has been dealing with the blockchain administrations. According to the OECD, it stands for the Organization for the Economic Growth and Cooperation Development. So OECD is an international organization which frames policies across the world. So the studies are according to its reports, about 112 countries, that includes European countries, East Asia and Pacific countries, are now agreed to the concept of the e-invoice. So to debunk the benefits of e-invoicing, various countries has conducted their own case studies. The case studies on the screen is of the France. According to this case study of France, this case study of France actually debunked the benefits of e-invoicing in numbers. Before the introduction of e-invoicing, that is during the pre-invoicing period, number of invoices handled by the employee in a year is 6,000. And the number of days that took to process those invoices, 15 days. And the cost of handling those invoices was 7 euros, which has been substantially reduced from 6,000 invoices to 90,000 e-invoices by one number. The days which were taken to process those invoices was 15, which has been reduced to 3 days in case of e-invoicing, and thus ensure 80% of our saving in times. Similarly, in terms of cost, the cost involved for the handling of those invoices was 7 euros. But with the introduction of e-invoicing, it has been reduced to 0.3 euros, which is equivalent to the 96%. And thus, it ensures very substantial increase in the cost reductions. Now, moving from the brief introduction of I would like to give some basic concepts of the e-invoicing. Now, what is basic understanding? What is e-invoicing? The e-invoicing, as its name suggests, is a mechanism that has been introduced by the government to digitize and standardize the process of generation of invoices. So GST Council, in its 37th meeting, decided to implement the e-invoicing on specified classes of persons. The specified classes of person we will discuss later on in this webinar. Now, why is e-invoicing? What is the purpose for the introduction of e-invoicing? The first and the foremost purpose for the introduction of e-invoicing is the simplification of GST reporting. In the current scenario, we all know we need to put the data, we need to feed the data at multiple stages. Suppose, like, we need to first put the data to the GST portal, then the same data to the e-way portal, and so on. But with the introduction of e-invoicing, the whole process of GST reporting becomes automated. Thus, the data once reported in the GST portal gets auto-populated to the e-way portal, and thus ensures simplification. Thus, we need not to enter the data at the multiple times. Another reason for the introduction of e-invoicing improves process automation. as we know that the e-invoicing automates the process of generation of invoices. In current scenarios, there is paper invoices and involves a human intervention. However, with the introduction of e-invoicing, human intervention will be there, but it will, the process of generation of invoicing will get automated. And some other object purpose for the introduction of invoicing is that it ensures the integrity of invoices. That is, it ensures the authenticity of the e-invoicing. Since the invoicing that has been generated is electronic, is in the form of electronic mode, and thus ensures better authenticity of the invoicing, alike in the current scenarios. From the recipient part of the e-invoicing helps to claim the input tax credit on the basis of the actual invoices. That is, it helps to reduce the claiming of ITC on the basis of fictitious invoices. Moving on to the next slide, that is objectives of e-invoicing. The first, as already discussed, the first objective of the e-invoicing is that it eliminates the manual data entry and automates the process. What is actually happening in the e-invoicing is that the e-invoicing created on one portal get auto-populated on other portals like e-Webbing portals, GST portals on the real-time basis, and thus it reduces the human intervention and transcriptional errors. Reduction in compliance issues. Nowadays, we face a lot of compliance issues in current scenarios. With the introduction of e-invoices, those of the compliance issues will be able to reduce. The e-invoicing helps to curb the tax evasion, and thus provides the authorities they can keep a bird eye view on each and every transaction on the real-time basis. Standard format. As the government has notified a schema, which we'll discuss later on, for the generation of e-invoicing. So this schema is standard for all the taxpayers. Thus the invoices generated from the one system can be easily readable to the other system. Therefore, it ensures the standardization of the process. Now, the another objective of invoicing is reduction in ITC related issues. Nowadays, many of the recipients face many difficulties in respect of the claiming of the eligible input tax credit. This has been majorly curbed with the introduction of e-invoicing. With the e-invoicing, the invoice which has been generated by the suppliers will get auto-populated on the recipient portal on real-time basis, and thus helps the buyer to ensure to take the eligible ITC. Now, some of the challenges. See, everything is not green. So, along with its objectives and advantages, e-invoicing has some of the challenges associated with it. The first challenge of the e-invoicing is a partial coverage. The e-invoicing concept is being, as we know, in current scenarios, we have to raise a number of the documents. Like, we have to raise tax invoices for B2B supplies, B2C supplies. We have to raise delivery challans, bill of supply for our exempt supply. So there are numerous of the documents which we need to issue in the current scenarios. The invoicing now for the time is been applicable only for the tax invoices, debit note, and the credit note. So for the other documents like delivery challans, bills of supply, job work documents, we need the invoicing will not be applicable, and thus we need to maintain a similar system. We need to maintain a parallel system for the same. Now, another challenge of the invoicing is mandatory and optional fees. The scheme, which has been notified by the government, has its own set of instructions associated with it, based on which the schema has to be filled by the taxpayer. If the data has not been captured according to that instructions, in that case,
Arucha, there is a lot of disturbance in your voice. Can you use earphones for a minute? Just earphones.
Yeah, yes, ma'am.
So is it better now?
Yeah. Looks better.
Sorry for the disturbance. We were discussing about the challenges on invoicing. I was discussing about the second challenges of the invoicing that has been related to the invoicing schema. So I was telling that the invoicing schema has its own set of instructions based on the which comply adhere to which we need to fill that schema. If the taxpayer doesn't fill the schema as per those instructions, it will throw an error, which will be a very difficult task for the taxpayers to understand. So these are the instructions. There are some cardinality codes. I will discuss about these codes later on in this webinar. So in case if the schema has not been filled as per those instructions, so the taxpayer will not able to capture the errors which will be thrown by the schema again and again. So this is also a challenge associated with the invoicing. The another and the last is the challenge of the invoicing is the implementation issues. As we all know that the invoicing concept is now it will become applicable from the 1st of October 2020. So there could be a chances that we will be requiring a lot of changes in our existing ERP systems to ensure its integrity with the invoicing systems. So thus, the taxpayers may face a tedious process, and the taxpayers may face teething problem associated with it. Now, some of the myths and the realities of the invoicing. So many taxpayers, many people have various myths with regards to the invoicing. Some of them are, do we need to generate the invoicing from the GST portal? No, the IRP portal will just only validate the invoices generated. Do we need to generate the invoicing for all the transactions? No, it has been applicable for the B2B transaction, that is for the business to business transactions. It is not there for the business to customer transactions, and it is also applicable for the exports. If I am not using any software, like if I am a small taxpayer and I am not using any kind of a software, even though can't I issue the invoicing? For that purpose, the government has come up with the 8 free software for the taxpayers whose aggregate turnover is up to 1.5 crores, and those softwares are easily available at the GST portal. Another myth is that will e-invoice add any of the more compliance to my existing compliances? No, the e-invoices will not add your compliances, rather it will reduce your compliances. As the moment you will get invoices pushed to your GST portal, the part A of the e-way bill will get auto-populated. Another myth is that is the IRN is the invoice number? No, IRN is just a reference number. The invoice number will be the same that has been generated by the taxpayer. IRN is just a reference number. We require a separate invoice format for different business? No, the government has notified the scheme which is standard for all the taxpayers, and thus there is a standardization. The invoice format will be same. So these are some of the myths and the realities in regard to the e-invoice. Now the applicability and legal aspects. Applicability and non-applicability. First of all, we need to understand on whom the invoice shall be applicable and on whom the invoicing shall not be applicable. As per the GST councils and the latest notifications, then GST the invoicing shall be applicable from the 1st of October 2020 to the taxpayers whose aggregate turnover in a financial year exceeds the threshold limit of 500 crores. Now, what exactly is a financial year? I will discuss about this in the next slide, but for which financial year we actually need to take the aggregate turnover to ascertain this 500 crores limit. So this is the applicability. Not applicability, invoicing is not applicable to the SEZ units, insurance companies, banking companies including NBFCs, GTAs are taxpayers, that is goods transport agencies, supplying passenger transportation services, supplier supplying services by way of admission, exhibition of cinematographic films in multiplex screens, etc. Key elements. So notification 13 of the 2020, dated 21st March 2020, discussed and notified about the e-invoicing. The key element that has been covered in the notification is that the e-invoicing shall be applicable on the aggregate turnover if exceeds rupees 500 crores during the financial year. Now, what exactly is the aggregate turnover? So in current scenarios as well, the section 26 of the CGST Act deals with the definition of aggregate turnover. The aggregate turnover includes your all the taxable supplies, including your exempt supplies, including your exports of goods, export of services, etc., but doesn't include your RCM supplies that has been related associated with the person having the same pen. Now, which turnover need to be considered in e-invoicing? Further, to check the applicability of e-invoicing, to check the threshold limit of 500 crores. As per the latest FAQs of government, the turnover of the which has been reported in the GSTN 3B of the previous financial year, that has to be considered to ascertain the limit of 500 crores. Previous financial year, now for the taxpayers on whom the e-invoicing shall be applicable from 1st October, which financial year we need to consider to ascertain the turnover. I will also come up to this particular aspect, but I will find in another slide. So basically now time being, as per FAQs, the turnover for to ascertain the limits of 500 crores, the turnover that has been reported by the taxpayer in their GSTR 3B has to be considered. Now this is another concept of self-declaration. Sometimes many of the taxpayers has been facing a problem that even if they have crossed a travel limit and e-invoicing becomes applicable, they face difficulties to get themselves registered on the portals. For that, the government will come up with an option of the self-declarations that the taxpayer can self-declare that it has been crossed the limit of 500 crores and e-invoicing is being applicable. However, it has not been yet enabled. It will be enabled soon, maybe in a couple of days. Now, in the last slide, I have discussed about that the turnover of the financial preceding financial year has to be considered. Now, what exactly is this financial year pertains to? So for the taxpayer on whom invoicing applicable from 1st October, is it the transaction, the turnover for the 17-18 shall be considered, 18-19 shall be considered, or for 19-20 shall be considered? So this is a burning issues nowadays. That is, which financial year turnover need to be considered? So it has been answered in the recent FAQs that has been issued by IRP, that is Invoice Registration Portal. The IRP, the FAQ says that the turnover, if during in these three financial year, if at any point of time in any of the financial year turnover exceeds 500 crore rupees, then the e-invoicing shall be applicable on such taxpayers. Let us understand this with an example. As you can see, there is a company A having an aggregate turnover of 565 crores in the financial year 17-18. However, its turnover in financial year 18-19 is 400 crores. And for the 19-20, it's only 350 crores. That is less with the threshold limit of 500 crores. Still, the e-invoicing shall be applicable on the company A, as FAQ says, in case if your turnover exceeds the threshold limit during any of the preceding financial years, the e-invoicing shall be applicable on you. Similarly, for the company B, the turnover of financial year 18-19 exceeds the threshold limit, the e-invoicing will become applicable. And for company C, the financial year of 19-20 exceeds the threshold limit of 500 crores, thus the e-invoicing shall also be applicable in company C. But for company D, the turnover of the preceding financial years, for the 17-18, 18-19, and 20-19-20. Any of the financial year does not exceed the threshold limit of 500 crores, thus the e-invoicing shall not be applicable on the company. Now, the documents. The another aspect which has been covered in e-invoicing, as I already mentioned, on which documents e-invoicing shall be applicable. So the same has been laid down, notified in notification 13. In current scenarios, we have multiple documents like tax invoice, bills of supply, for the exam supply, you have delivery channels for the job workers, you have self-invoicing in case of your RCM supplies. So on which type of documents actually will be the invoicing applicable? So the government PPT says the invoicing shall become applicable for on the invoices raised by the supplier, credit notes raised by the supplier, and debit note raised by the supplier. Thus, it has not been applicable on the delivery challenge, bills of supply, job work. So for those documents, we need to keep a separate systems in operation simultaneously with the e-invoicing systems. Now, schema. The government, as I already discussed, the government has introduced a schema on which you have to put your data and then it will create the JSON file which you will push it to the IRP portal. So this is the whole process which we will discuss later on. So this schema has some certain, this schema has been notified by the government on 30th of July 2020 in notification 16/2020. So this schema, it's in Excel format, and this schema has two fields in it. The one is mandatory fields and the optional fields. The mandatory fields indicate the fields which are mandatory need to be reported. And the optional fields, that has been optional, and you can or you may or you may not fill that fields. So this schema fields has been divided into 12 sections and 6 annexures. So these 12 sections are mandatory in nature, and these six annexures are optional in nature. So out of 12 sections, 5 are mandatory. The one is basic details. The basic details like invoice numbers, GSTN numbers of the suppliers, and all this. Supplier information, its address, its GSTN number, name, etc. Recipient information, that is recipient GSTN number, recipient name, its address, etc. Invoice item details, like which commodities are you dealing with, what is the HSN rate associated with it, etc. And the document totals, the taxable value, the document total is like invoice amount, which includes the taxable amount, tax rate, tax amount. So in schema has 12 sections, out of which mandatory requirement of these 5 details are there. If you are not providing these 5 details, or if you are missing any of the details, the schema will keep on pushing the address. And out of the 6 annexures in the schema, 2 are mandatory. The one is item details. You need to enter the item details in which you are dealing, and the document total details. You need to mention the document details, that is your invoice value in the current system. Now the schema has been revised from time to time by various notifications. As for the latest notification, these are some of the changes which has been incorporated in the schema, which was not there before in this schema. Thus, some of the changes are IGST on the interest rate supplies. So this column was not there before. Now in case if you have any interest rate supplies on which IGST has been charged, so there is a separate column in the schema in which you have to incorporate its details. Discount total sections. Earlier there was no discount total sections. There was not such kind of fields. Now it has been there in the schema. In case if you have provided any discount, you can incorporate your details here. Other charges. The other charges, sometimes it happens that in invoice, there are lots of other charges has been incorporated apart from the taxable values, on which GST will not be applicable, like income tax, TCS, like your freight charges. Like in case you have reimbursed any of the expenses, that has also been there on the invoices. However, GST will not be applicable on those expenses charges. So you can now incorporate those amount in this column other charges. You just need to mention the amount and the details of the other charges. Export duties. Earlier there was an information regarding to the export, that is bills of in regards to the export. Now export, however, the field export duty was not there. It has been now external. It has been added external. Now state name for the supplier, buyer, place of supply, ship to and dispatch from the fields. So these are the some of the fields which are now has been incorporated in the schema and which were not there before this revised scheme has been notified. Another additional feature is like additional currency codes, state codes. Earlier it was a state name, country code of exports, etc. You can also type your supply type code. What is your supply? Is it a tax invoice? Is it exempt supply? Is it taxable supply? It's document type code. What document type it is? It is a bills of supply. What exactly it is it our type or document type? Vehicle type. That is it a regular type vehicle or other type? So these are the some of the addition which has been incorporated in the schema, and we can use it as per our requirements. Now, as I already mentioned previously, there is some cardinality in the scheme, in this schema, which indicates the mandatory and the optional fields. That has been instructed. The optional field, we need to incorporate it optionally, and mandatory field, we need to incorporate it mandatory. So the each cardinality is marked as 0.1, 1.1, 1.n, 0.n in this schema. So it indicates the mandatory fields and the whether the field by particular details can be repetitive or cannot be repetitive. Notation which starts with zero, its meaning is that it is an optional field. And the notation it starts with one, it indicates a mandatory field. The notation which starts with n, I will discuss it with an example later on. The notation which starts with n, it is a data for the field can be entered only once. It cannot be repeat. Ends with n, the data can be entered in multiple times. As an illustration, if any cardinality is 0.1, so 0 starts with 0, that means it is optional. And ends with 1, that means the data can be entered only once. So it is basically the optional field, and the data can be entered only once. If you are opting to fill that scheme, enter the data only once. So example of this is like RCM details, supplier email number. It is optional to provide those details. But if you're providing, you can provide it only once. Now another cardinality is 1.1. The one, though it has been started with one, that means it is a mandatory field. Ends with one, that is, it is mandatory. Simultaneously, data can be entered only once, like IRN. Document number, invoice number. It is mandatory to provide your invoice number, and you can also provide invoice number only once. That is, invoice number cannot be repeated. Supplier's information. The supplier's information, like its GSTR number, its name, address, it is mandatory to provide those information. And further, those cannot be repeated. Another example is 1.n, that is starts with m, one, that is mandatory field, and n with n, the data can be entered multiple times. Now, what is the information which we can enter, which is required to be mandatory provided, and can enter the multiple times? It's the item descriptions. Item, suppose if I'm dealing in any commodities, and I'm providing three of that commodities, so I need to mention each commodities, but that can be repeat, that can be entered multiple times. The last one is 0.n, that is 0.n. 0 indicates it is optional field. Simultaneously, it can be entered multiple of time, like product details, any of your preceding reference number. So this is your decision whether to report those requirements or not. So based on these cardinality, the data has to be captured in the schema. If the schema has not been filled, on the basis of these cardinalities. It will throw an error and you have to report the data according to these cardinalities only. Now, who can access to the IRP and e-invoicing systems? What is IRP? IRP is Invoice Registration Portal. We'll discuss it once. We'll discuss about the process of e-invoicing. So IRP is a portal in which the documents will be thrown. So who can access to the IRP system? The businessman whose aggregate turnover is exceeds rupees 500 crores, that is the taxpayers on whom e-invoicing shall be applicable. GSPs and ASPs. The GSPs and ASPs will be discussed later in detail by Mr. Gaurav Mohan in the technical aspects of the invoicing. And the IT service providers that are providing the services to their clients, they can access to the IRP systems on the behalf of their clients. So these are the some of the persons or the taxpayers who can actually access to the IRP systems. The one is the taxpayers with the more than 500 crores of turnover, GSPs, ASPs, and IT service providers. These are just some latest important updates with the e-invoicing. Like for the applicability of invoices, the notification 13/2020 has been there, which has been further amended by notification 61. And it indicates that the invoicing shall be applicable for the tax classes of per specified person whose aggregate turnover exceeds 500 crores. For e-invoicing schema, notification 60 amends the notification 13/2020. It provides a schema. A new form GSTINV has been notified for these revised schema for this e-invoicing. Excluded sectors, as I already discussed, there are some sectors on which e-invoicing shall not be applicable, like special SEZs, banking sectors, insurance sectors. So these all sectors has been notified in notification number 61/2020 that has been notified on 30th of July 2020. Also, this notification enhances the limit from earlier limit of 100 crores to the 500 crores. For the invoice form, a new rule 48-4 has been inserted by notification 68, which inserts a new rule 48 that describes that classes of registered person is required to maintain to issue this e-invoicing form in the form GST INV 01. Now the changes in compliances and the reporting. So as you know, this e-invoicing, the concept of e-invoicing has implemented various changes in our existing compliancing and reporting process. Now what are these? So this is a comparison between the present system of invoicing and the e-invoicing system. IRN, that is invoice reference number. In the present system, there is no concept of IRN. There is only an invoice number. In invoicing system, there is an IRN as well as there is an invoice number. The invoice number will be the same that has been raised by these, generated by the taxpayers. However, the IRN is a number which contains some of the hash algorithm in it that has been provided by the IRP portals. Now, the validation of invoices. In the present system, there is no such validation facilities been providing on the GST portals that you can just go and validate and download the invoicing. There is no such facilities provided. In e-invoicing system, you can easily validate the invoices, as the invoice once validated will get be notified by to the suppliers through on its registered email IDs. Digital signatures. In the present system, only the authorized signature was required. However, in this e-invoicing system, this validated invoices, it has to be digitally signed by the IRP portal. Along with the signatures of taxpayers, it has been digitally signed. QR code. There is no concept of the QR code in the present systems. In e-invoicing, there is a concept of QR code. The validated invoices, once provided by the IRP, it contains a QR code. This QR code can be used to verify the invoices, even though we don't have an internet facility available. The government has now introduced app-based systems for your mobile, app-based applications, or a mobile-based application for your mobiles, through which you can just scan the QR code on the invoices and get the whole details of the invoices. So this concept was not there in the present system of invoicing. Verification and invoicing, it is very much a difficult task in the present system to ensure the genuineness of the invoices, to verify the genuineness of the invoices. If you are doing the inspections or if you are doing an audit. In case of e-invoicing, it is very much easy to ensure the genuineness as you can easily scan the QR code and also check the IRN and get the details associated with those particular invoices. So these are some of the changes that has been occurred in case of the e-invoicing system that are not present in the current systems. Linkages. So there are some of the bundling issues in regards to the e-invoicing, that how the credit note will be linked in the original invoices. In the current systems, if the supplier or the taxpayers raises any of the credit note, then it must contain the details of the original invoices. Also, by reporting those credit notes at the GST portal, we require to punch the original invoice details, like against which this invoice credit note has been raised, what was the invoice date, what was the HSN code of that original invoice, what was the tax stream. So in this current system, we have to report all these details associated with the credit notes. That is, there is a linkage of the credit note with the original invoice. But after the e-invoicing, there is no linkaging or there is no validation of the credit note with the original invoices. You need to just incorporate the details of your credit note as if you are incorporating the details of your tax invoices. There is no linking of, there is no need to provide you the linking of original invoice number, its date, its HSN code, etc. Reverse charge invoices. One of the major ambiguity point in case of the invoicing is the applicability of the invoicing in case of the reverse charge mechanism. So just to a brief description of reverse charge is a transaction in which the supplier recipient has to pay the tax on the behalf of supplier. Now the question, one of the major questions arises in the reverse charge invoices is that who generates the invoice in case of RCM? Suppose if I am a supplier and I am providing advocate services that is covered under the reverse charge mechanism. So do I need to provide the invoicing? Or the recipient who is availing the services from me and paying the tax on the reverse charge, he needs to raise an invoice. So prima facie and firstly, the supplier, that is the advocate, has to raise an e-invoices if its turnover exceeds 500 crores. Now there is two scenarios covered in the RCM. The first is if we are B2B transactions. Like in current scenario, what exactly happens, B2B transaction, that is a GTA services. If we are taking any kind of a GTA services on which RCM is applicable, we need to pay the tax on the RCM basis. Also, however, in the e-invoicing schema, if the supplier exceeds the threshold limit of 500 crores, then that GTA has to raise an e-invoicing with the RC flag in it. He has to check, like in the current situation also, he has to click on the chat box that whether the RCM is applicable or not. So similarly, he has to raise an invoice with RC flag on it. Now in case of B2C transactions, in the current scenario, if a taxpayer is receiving any services from the unregistered dealers on which which reverse charge has been applicable, in that case, the taxpayer has to raise a self-invoicing. Taxpayer has to do the self-invoicing and also similarly report those so-called self-invoicing series in its GSTR1. But the same concept is not same in case of e-invoicing. In case of e-invoicing B2C transactions, there is no need to generate a self-invoicing. The IRN need not to be generated. So thus, for a nutshell, in case of reverse charge invoices, you will see the supplier has to raise the e-invoicing even though the tax has been paid by the recipient, but the supplier, if his turnover exceeds the threshold limit, he has to raise the e-invoicing in case of e-invoicing scheme. Now I use applicability on ISD. Now what is ISD? ISD is an input service distributor. ISD has in its officer, as in its office, is a supplier of goods which is providing the services, which is taking the services on the behalf of its branches on all, and then distribute the tax and then distribute its input services that has been taken to all its branches. That is, ISD is an input service distributor. It distributes the services to its branches on the same, having the same PAN number. Now the scope of ISD under e-invoicing. The ISD can distribute in current scenarios as well. ISD distributes its taxes on the basis of tax invoices. In this case also, the ISD can raise the tax invoices, but as per the FAQs released by GSTN, the e-invoicing shall not be applicable on the ISDs. The IRAN is not required to be generated on the ISD because the notification says it has to be generated for the tax invoices. And for the ISD, they are distributing, they are actually distributing the inputs. Though they do those so by the tax invoices, but that tax invoices need not to push at the IRP and the IRN need not to be required to be generated on those tax invoices. Income taxes and the invoicing, as I already discussed in the schema, there is another column has been incorporated, indicate the other charges in the field. So in case if an invoice carries any of the information, in case if invoice carries any of the information that is on which GST is not applicable, so we can indicate those details in the other charges, like income tax TCS is one of them. Once there is no separate field in schema, if recording this, you need to incorporate the same in the other charges only. Also, once IRN has been obtained, the businesses can also eliminate, incorporate those details and the charges in the scheme. Now, with the introduction of the concept of e-invoicing, some of the auto, as I already discussed, some of the it automates the process, and it also generates the auto, it also auto populates many fields. Like in GSTR1, we have table number 4A, 4B, 4C. So that contains the details of B2B invoices that will be auto-populated once the invoices have been pushed by the IRP. The 6A details, which contains the details of export invoices, that has also been auto-populated. 9B, that includes the details of credit note, debit note that has been issued to the registered person. So that will get auto-populated. Acceptance summaries of the output supplies, it will get auto-populated. Cancellation of e-invoicing. The GST system will handle the invoicing. Once any transaction will be auto-populated and invoicing will get cancelled, we can do so once the invoicing has been cancelled. So the information related to that particular cancelled invoices will automatically get cancelled from the GSTR1 portal. Taxpayers, once the information has been pushed to the GSTR1, the taxpayer can easily edit those details. Now, suppose if the IRP pushed the details to the GST portals, and after pushing the details, the IRN and the invoices gets cancelled. For that cancelled invoice, the taxpayer has to intimate the details to their respective officers. So this is all about the auto fields that has been auto populated in the GSTR1 white e-invoicing schemes. So this is all from my side. Now for the process, for the discussion about the process and the technical aspects of e-invoicing, I would like to take over the charge to Mr. Gaurav Mohan, who is CEO of organization. Thank you everyone. In case if anyone has any questions and queries related to the legal aspects of the e-invoicing, they can ask them and they can also put the same in the chat box.
Hello. Thank you, Richa, giving us the details. Let us look in detail about the process flow and how it will happen. Just a minute. Let me. So this is the process of e-invoicing. Firstly, a taxpayer will generate an invoice in his own software, accounting ERP software. Then he will convert it into a JSON format as per the schema. Once it is converted into a JSON format, then it will be pushed to the IRP, invoice registration portal. Invoice registration portal will do its various checks, like the check of the supplier GSTN, recipient GSTN, other information, that like the document number, document type, whether this is a repeat, deduplication check will also be done. If it is validated, if all is good with the invoice, IRP will generate a unique IRN, invoice reference number, a QR code, and a digital signature. All these will be put affixed to the JSON format and send it back to the taxpayer. Then taxpayer can convert this into a PDF format or even send a JSON file to its customer as he has his dealings with the customer. IRP will simultaneously push this data to the three places. As Richard told you, it's only 24 hours that the IRP keeps any invoice information. After that, that information is moved to the central KYC registry, where it will be kept for future purposes. Then second place, it is pushed to the GST system, where it will be used for auto population of GSTR 1 and 2A, and for now 2B as well, will be auto populated because of the supplier's information that he has pushed to the IRP portal. Then this authenticated payload, which was approved by the IRP, will also be pushed simultaneously to the eBabel portal. So part A will get auto-populated. Even part B can get auto-populated if you have put in all the required details. So this will decrease a lot of effort. So right now, our accountants have to first generate an invoice, then push it again at the 11th of the month to GSTR 1, then to 3B, and then to the eBay Pay portal. All this has to be done by, and four times, same thing has been done. This is expected to be reduced to once. And even in the future, it is expected that the purchaser will also be working on an ERP which can understand these JSONs and will automatically have a purchase booked in its ledgers rather than getting an accountant to put in all these details. It will be done through systems. So I think this is going to take a lot of jobs. So this is the process of e-invoicing. Firstly, as I discussed, there will be invoice creation. Then it will be uploaded in a JSON format to the IRP. IRP will authenticate it. After authentication, it will share the data with the eBabel system, GST system, and it will also can be downloaded by the taxpayer and shared with its customer. Now let us look at some of the features in very detail. Firstly, is the most important new term that has been coined is the invoice reference number or the IRN. So IRN is a unique number, which consists of the GSTN of the supplier, the financial year in which it pertains to, the document type, and the document number. All these four will always be unique. It cannot be repeated in a financial year. So if you will know, as you know, same document number cannot be repeated in a financial year. So all this combination will always be unique. So IRN will always be unique for any taxpayer in a financial year or even in a, so one IRN can only be there for one type of invoice for a particular supplier. The IRN will be 64 character length. I'll show you an example. By adding all these details, they do a 256 character bit technical thing and they make it into 64 characters. So earlier, it was given in an FAQ that IRN can also be generated by the taxpayer. So it's a simple tool. Then IRN using this can also hash his own IRN. But this has been changed. Now IRN can only be generated by the IRP. Now taxpayers do not have the option of giving their own IRN. It has to be generated on the IRP portal itself. So this is how an IRN will look like. This is a GSTN, financial year 1920, invoice number and the date. Once we join all this together and hash it into a coded language, this will be the IRN, which is 64 character length. Sorry. So as I informed to you, all this data is kept with the IRP for only 24 hours. After 24 hours, this information is passed away and cannot be amended. So for any cancellation, it is 24 hours. Again, so there was an issue ki how long can you generate an invoice? For example, if I generate an invoice today, if the invoice date is of today and I generate, by what time I have to report it to the IRP? Because many companies want to do it in a batch process. They do not need real-time invoicing. They, as it is also a B2B transaction, it is not necessarily real-time where we, our supplier is or our customer is standing on the door and we have to give it. We can do it in a batch process once a week or so. When the IRP trial phase was running, it was earlier only 24 hours. So if I have any invoice which is dated today, which is 27th of September, I can push it to IRP only by the 28th. It will not accept anything which is more than 1 day prior. But due to a lot of requests and repeated to the IRP portal, now this has been changed. Now the time limit for generation of 24 has been relaxed and given away. Now you can generate your invoice even within a week. There is no time limit. So we have, what a taxpayer has to be careful of is that any invoice that you generate is not a valid invoice till it is authenticated by the IRP. So if I generate an invoice today, I cannot move the goods. I cannot issue it to the supplier, to the recipient. I cannot generate an e-way bill till I get it authenticated by the IRP. So even if I have an invoice date of today, I can push it to the IRP in 1 week's time before, just before giving it to the recipient or moving any goods on that invoice. So also to add to it, as the data is kept for 24 hours, IRN can be canceled within 24 hours only. If it is canceled beyond 24 hours, you cannot do it in the IRP. The data has already been pushed to the GSTN portal. You have to go and do it manually in the GSTR1 that this invoice has been canceled. And as Richard told you, any changes that you do to the auto-populated data will be flagged or informed to a respective jurisdiction officer. So it is highly recommended that any changes done to the auto-populated data has to be carefully scrutinized and all documents should be kept in record that why any change has been done. What was the reason of canceling an invoice after 24 hours? So this is very important. Otherwise, undue scrutiny will be done by the officer. So IRN will be mandatory for e-way bills. And if there is an e-way bill, you cannot cancel IRN. We will cover this point in detail in the upcoming slides. And another thing, which is a practice in many organizations, once you cancel an invoice, people use that invoice number using a backdated entry within the same month. So for example, I generated an invoice on 2nd of September. I canceled it. Then on 30th September, that person may generate another invoice as it has not been reported to the portal. But now once an IRN is generated and then canceled, you cannot use the same IRN. You have to move to the next IRN. Same IRN cannot be used. So as discussed, IRN has to be generated by the IRP. It cannot be generated by the taxpayer. You can check your applicability of e-invoicing on this portal of e-invoice1.gst.gov.in. If you punch your GSTN number, you will be able to see whether e-invoicing is applicable or not. On this portal, they have used the turnover reported in 3B on the financial year 17-18, 18-19, 19-20 has been auto calculated for all the taxpayers across PAN-based turnover for all the taxpayers across the country. PAN-based has been calculated. If your turnover, according to your 3B, crosses 500 crores, you can see if you punch your GSTN, it will say that it is applicable on you. What validations does the IRP system does? As discussed, it checks the GSTN of supplier, GSTN of the recipient, the document date, the document type, the tax rates. For example, 8% tax rate is not a valid tax rate. It will show you an error. Certain HSN codes are not valid. It will show you an error. The financial year, the file format, all this will be checked by the IRP system before validating. 24-hour storage, I've already discussed. And IRP, there are 10 portals that has been notified by the government. So to enable a real-time upload, and also it is expected that they will respond with an IRN within 100 milliseconds. Like a blink of an eye, you will be able to see your IRN. It should not take very long. Let's see what happens on the 1st of October. But this will be there. And also they have given a bulk Excel upload option, which we'll discuss in next slides. e-invoice, so as e-invoicing and e-way bill portal has been seamlessly linked, integrated. Now the same credentials for this e-way bill system will work on the e-invoicing system. So generation and cancellation of the e-way bill, as I discussed, any e-way bill can be generated if your turnover is above 500 crore, can be generated only if there is a valid IRN for that invoice. If there is not a valid IRN, you cannot generate an e-way bill. And it goes the other way while going for cancellation. If you want to cancel an IRN or an invoice, if it cannot be canceled if there is a valid e-way bill that has been generated on it. So we have to first cancel the e-way bill. After cancellation of e-way bill, then only we can cancel the invoice. So it goes in a circle. For generation, first the invoice has to be generated, then e-way bill has to be generated. In cancellation, goes the other way. First the e-way bill has to be canceled, then only the IRN can be canceled. It has been given an FAQ that physical copy of the invoice or e-way bill is no longer required. You can carry it on your mobile handheld devices, which can scan the QR code. The devices cannot be so small that you are not able to scan the QR code and that officer on field officer is not able to verify the details. Let us look at the QR code. So IRP along with IRN will also send you back a QR code. The purpose of QR code as described is for helping the tax officers to check the details, whether this is a valid invoice or not. What will the QR code consist of? QR code will consist of the GSTN of the supplier, the GSTN of the recipient, invoice number as given by the supplier, date of generation of the invoice value, number of line items the invoice has, the HSN code of the main item, and the unique IRN and the IRN generation date. So at a similar point of time, there has been introduction of QR code for B2C invoices, which created some confusion. To clarify in this and the next slides, we'll just go in a little bit detail. So there is a QR code that has to be put even in case of a B2C invoice. But that has nothing to do with the QR codes of B2B invoices. QR code of B2B invoices are generated by the IRP. These QR codes has to be generated by your own accounting software or the ERP softwares while billing to any B2C transaction. So for B2C transaction, they have given a dynamic QR code. While B2B, that's a static QR code. Our notification number 14 refers to B2C transaction 14/20/20 and 13 refers to B2B transaction, both were dated 21st March. So this is applicability is for both similar type of taxpayers who have their turnover, aggregate turnover, PAN-based turnover above 500 crores. The purpose of the dynamic QR code was to enable the customer to do a UPI-based payment through their mobile banking. And the static QR code was basically to verify the B2B invoices reported and curbing of fake invoices. The fake invoicing has grown and there's a lot of litigation that is going on. Many notices are being received. So this is a mechanism. That is why government is bringing, even in the COVID situation, it is expected to be rolled out on 1st of October as of now. And there doesn't seem to be an extension because fake invoicing has taken a lot of the heat during the GST era. Let us look at how this printing will be done. So printing of QR code is mandatory. You have to print the QR code. It is printing of QR code is mandatory, but printing of IRN is not mandatory. IRN is anyways a very technical thing, 64 character length, which no individual can understand. So it is not mandatory and it is also part of a QR code. Once you scan it, you will be able to see the IRN. So it is not mandatory to print the IRN, but printing of QR code is mandatory. Where do we print the QR code? As you know, the government has not prescribed any schema for printing. You can print the QR code anywhere in the invoice. It should be prominently clear and it should be scannable. What size? There is no size that has been recommended by the government or notified. Generally, it has to be readable. So B2C QR code is not applicable since B2C invoices are to be accepted. Printing, it's optional because IRN, as I already discussed, you can have your own format, you can put in your logos, whatever format, there is no format. As in the currently rule 46, there is no format that has been prescribed. Only details have been given. Similarly, in rule 48 for INV01, only details have been given. There is no format. You can choose your format. You can choose your logo, whatever you want to do. One thing that has changed is currently authorized signatory has to affix his signature, digital signature, whatever. But now, as these invoices, e-invoices will be signed by the IRP portal, there is no requirement of signature by the taxpayer. You can also print these invoices on the e-invoice portal. There is a portal where you put the acknowledgement number or the IRN and you can print these invoices. Another thing that has changed is INV01 does not require the invoice to be generated in triplicate. So currently, as per rule invoicing rules, service providers have to generate invoices in duplicates, while goods suppliers have to generate invoice in triplicate. One for original for the recipient, duplicate for the transporter, and triplicate for the recipient. But this requirement has been given away with. Now you can only print only one invoice. This is an e-invoicing. Now let us look at the detailed understanding for the modes of invoicing. So this is a very technical aspect, but very important for us to understand that there are three different mechanisms by which e-invoice can be generated. Firstly is the offline bulk upload facility, which has been given by the taxpayer on the IRP portal. A taxpayer can upload the file containing the multiple invoices, and we will have a look at it in detail. Second is the direct API integration. A taxpayer with a strong in-house team can directly access to the APIs. You can get yourself authenticated and you will get the government APIs, and you can access them and get a real-time invoicing. The third method is the API integration through GST. If you do not want to do it in-house, you can pay someone like GST Suvidha providers, the GSPs, and then they will be able to generate those IRNs for you. So let us look at the bulk upload facility in detail. So bulk IRN, this is an Excel-based utility which has been given on the portal, which is where you can push multiple invoices at once to the portal, and you will get the necessary details of IRN and QR codes and digital signature back to you, and invoice will be generated. The issue is still that you have to make certain changes in your ERP to push those details firstly in an Excel format, and then get those details back and get it converted into a printable format. This will be done sequentially. It's okay. What the aim behind the bulk offline tool is to make it cost effective. It's almost negligible cost if you go for a bulk offline tool. Companies with large value transaction, even if they crosses 500 crore turnover, but they don't want to go for a seamless integration, they do not need real-time invoicing, can always opt for bulk offline tool for batch production of this e-invoices. Save their cost and they can do with it. So bulk upload facility has been uploaded on the e-invoice portal through this portal. Now there are four formats which has been given by the e-invoice portals. The requirements, so it depends on the different requirements or different class of taxpayers. A taxpayer can have different line items. They want to push payment details. They want to get reference details. Whatever details they have, government has given four very different kind of formats, depending on the details that a taxpayer wants to punch in their invoices or is required to punch in their invoices. So they are format A, B, C, and D. So format A is a single worksheet. This is the simplest of all the formats. You can, this is how it looks like. You can punch in the basic mandatory details and you can get it validated on the Excel offline tool. Once it is validated, you can generate a JSON format. So this is ideal for a businesses which have only one to two line items and in an invoice. they do not have multiple line items, then you can go for an invoicing. Furthermore, payment details and reference details cannot be entered in formatter. So it's a relatively easier one to generate an e-invoice. Then the next level up is the format B. Format B contains one Excel sheet consists of two worksheets. One is for your document details or the invoice details, and second is for the item details. Like if you have many items, number of line items in an invoice, then it will be more suitable for you to use format type B. And how these invoices in the two different sheets has been linked, the document number, document date, and the document type are the common fields in the two sheets through which the invoice will be referenced. So it is very important to make sure that these are right. If these are wrong or misput, then it will not be referenced correctly and you will face a lot of issues. Payment details and reference details again cannot be entered in format B. It is level 2. Then the most detailed format is the format C. It contains of 5 worksheets. One worksheet is for the invoice details. Second is the item details, the number of line items, goods that you are supplying. Third is the payment details. Fourth is the reference details. And fifth is the additional details. So this format is ideally advisable if you want to give your payment details and reference details in addition to the invoice details and item details. And as informed earlier, this has been referenced using the document number, document type, and document date. Any errors in this will create a lot of problems. So it has to be correctly put in all. And this is, these three items are unique and are same in the different 5 worksheets. Then there is a format D. Format D contains all the details, but in a single worksheet. So format C and format D are somewhat together, somewhat similar. Just format C had divided these details into 5 different worksheets, which needs to be referenced using the document details. But in format D, all the details are put in one Excel sheet. It's a big Excel sheet. And you can put in all the details, including the payment details, reference details, item details, everything in one worksheet, validate it, generate a JSON, and post to the portal for e-invoice. Now, cancellation. How will we cancel this invoices? There is a separate utility that has been given for cancellation of e-invoices. Earlier, during the offline utility of GST1, if you remember, there is a flag that you can put. You can just put a flag like cancelled invoice. You put yes, it becomes cancelled. It is not the case in e-invoicing. There is separate utility that has been provided altogether. And separate portal where you have to upload. Now, portal is the same, separate link, you can say. For the cancellation of invoices, it covers only the very basic details. You have to give the IRN, as you know, unique IRN, that is the identification number for your invoice. The cancel reason, why are you cancelling that invoice? And the cancel remarks, like for example, they have given a dummy thing. This order is cancelled because order is cancelled by the buyer, and data enter a mistake or some mistake has been done. This can be done, and as you know, this cancellation on the portal can be done within 24 hours only. After 24 hours, you cannot use this tool, and it cannot be cancelled. After processing the JSON file, and they will cancel the IRN, display the status as cancelled. Or the show the errors. So this was all about the offline bulk upload facility. Now we go to the direct API integration. It is important for us to understand all these processes so that we can consult our clients accordingly and give them the introduction to these kind of methods that they have possibly used. So e-invoice APIs are used for a direct data exchange between the taxpayer or the GSP systems and the e-invoice system. APIs can be accessed only after a successful authentication. An authentication token and SEK is generated by the system. So for any API onboarding, there are a lot of prerequisites. I've only listed a few. So if any taxpayer who wants to directly get access to the APIs, to the government IRP portals, then you need to make sure of these technical requirements. I've just given a brief so that we have some idea about it. So your invoice generation process has to be automated. your payload data, the traffic that you are sending, should be free of viruses, malwares, any intrusion, bots, threats. If there is certain these things, you will be blocked and you will be in the soup and not be able to generate any invoicing. The government of India IT security standard has to be adhered to. Adequate bandwidth has to be given to connect to the invoice system. This facility, all the taxpayers, GSPs, ERPs, e-commerce systems should be certified by SSL or TSL. Whitelisting is required for the static IP addresses. Pre-production system for testing, and they have to modify their pre-production site with all the type of activities. So I am giving you just a brief of how many technical changes will be required by the taxpayers to make sure that they are able to access the APIs of the government. So if you have a very good, flexible and agile IT team, then the taxpayer can go for API integration. Otherwise, it can be an uphill battle. And just to get a little bit in more detail, there are different APIs for authentication, generation of IRN, cancellation of IRN, getting the e-invoice details, generation of the e-way bill details, and the get GST details. So, authentication APIs will, and first you get yourself self-registration on the portal, then these API credentials needs to be authenticated on the API system. Once this authentication is done of the API, then only you get the APIs. So generation of IRN, there is one type of IRN which can be used for the generation of the IRNs. The payload that will be sent from the taxpayers or the GSPs for the generation of IRN is as per the JSON format already discussed in the schema. You can cancel this. There is a separate API for cancellation, which has to be done within 24 hours. If you want to get fetch any details of invoices, there is an API given for that. The JSON will get all those IRN details and the signed invoice. So generation of IRN is the generate IRN API is for pushing the details. Get invoice detail is for receiving the details. So this is an API where we receive the details, which will include the IRN, signed invoice and the signed QR code. Then there is separate invoice, separate API for generation of e-way bills. If you want to generate e-way bill, you can put all the details, party is already covered, then you can put the transporter IDs, transport vehicle details, and you can also generate the e-way bills using these APIs. If you want to get the JSON, that also API is available. So this is available currently on the e-invoice API sandbox. All these details are available. On the API sandbox, four type of users have been enabled and can get themselves registered. A taxpayer, if your turnover is above 500 crore, then you can get yourself registered. Otherwise, this registration is not feasible. Second is the GSP. The GST Suvidha providers can get themselves registered and get access to these APIs. GSPs will use their PAN number. Then we come to the e-commerce operator. E-commerce operator will use their TCS GSTIN, the mobile numbers and email ID to get themselves registered. Then fourth is the ERPs like the Tally or Oracle or SAPs. They can also get access to the API systems for generation of e-invoicing. The third we look at integration. The third process is the integration through GSP. So GST Suvidha providers have been, there's a whole list of GSPs which have been enlisted by the IRPs, which have been given the rights to access all these details from the IRP. So how it will happen is taxpayer, instead of following all those technical requirements, GSP will be following. So taxpayers will push their details to the GSP. In how they integrate it, it is between the taxpayer and the GSP. There are different methods possible. And once it is pushed to the GSP, GSP will convert it into the APIs and push it to the GSTN server. This can be done, it is ideally been done in two methods. One is the SFTP portal where many taxpayers have protected data and they do not want to share the entire data or do a seamless integration. They make a folder which is accessible to the GSPs. GSPs access the data from that folder and push it to the IRP portals. And after getting the details from the IRP, it again pushes all the detail back into a similar or another folder, and where taxpayers can then fetch this detail into their ERP software and invoice will be generated. The second is a seamless API integration where ERP softwares of the taxpayers will have APIs which are linked to the GSP's APIs, and then GSP APIs will be linked to the IRP and vice versa. And it will be a seamless integration. The time can be within few minutes. We should be able to have invoices even with GSPs or the direct API integration. So this is our view. What will be the advantages of using a GSP? So there is seamless integration. You can, so if you are using a bulk offline facility, there is, you can do it in a batch process. You cannot do it in a real time basis. So if you, let us, if you're a hotelier and there is a customer standing and given a GSTN for a B2B invoice, he cannot wait there for you to Excel upload and then push it to the portal. That is not possible. So you have to go through, if there is a real time, that then it has to be done through GSPs or APIs. All the security requirement that I talked about at the time of API will not be required by if you use the GSP mode, because GSP will already fulfill all those details, and you only have to fulfill what the requirements, minimal requirement that GSP gives to you for data security. As you remember, 3 years back when the GST was introduced, GSTN has done so many changes in the 3 years. So similar changes may be expected in the API or the e-invoice portals as well. So if there's any change in API or any changes in the schema, then APIs will change, changes has to be done. So maybe flexibility will be more with the GSP because they have a host of team working solely for e-invoicing, while our in-house team will not be specialized in invoicing. That's just part of their job. So if you're think your team is very agile and flexible, you can go for an in-house team. Otherwise, you can consider GSPs. They are more flexible, they're dynamic. Also, many GSPs now provide reports, reconciliations, which can be useful in future, which is not possible definitely in bulk offload facility. Or in the APIs, it is possible, but then you have to get those reports generated. So offline facility is definitely not scalable. APIs may also cause an issue, but GSPs can be easily scalable. Let us compare the three now. So if there is no requirement for real-time invoicing, you can go for an offline tool and do a batch production. It will be most cost-effective. If there is a real, if there is a requirement that you need to get a real-time invoicing and you have to do it, then either go for APIs, direct API integration, or GSPs. If you have a very strong in-house team, go for API integration. Otherwise, if it's limited in-house team and you don't want to put pressure, then you can go for GSPs. Offline tool, most effective. I don't think there is any cost. Little changes will be required in the ERP and you can get through it. APIs, direct API integration should be more cost effective. And secondly, there should not be recurrent cost. While GSP will definitely take an annual maintenance charge or per invoice charges, which in the long run will definitely be more. So in the offline tool, you will require manpower at the time of generation of invoice. Initially, at the time of implementation, there is not much manpower required, but once you need to issue an invoice, there will be a lot of effort. It's not seamlessly integrated with the system. But with the APIs and GSPs, both will be seamlessly integrated. And operationally, daily activities, there should not be much of an effort. Only on a single click of a button, we should be able to generate IRNs from the IRP portals. So technical requirements, as I discussed, there are technically you don't need to make any changes like whitelisting, virus, malware. All this is not required on the offline tool. API, there is a host of technical requirements that I only showed a glimpse to. GSP will be relatively easier for the technical requirements, but all those government requirements will be required by GSP, and GSP want to sell it to you. So they want to keep their requirements minimum just to protect their data. Errors. So if you punch in any errors in the offline tool, it will only come to you once that you send it to the IRP convert. Either during validation, it will be reported to you if there is very gross error. If the error is inherent, like some mistake in the GSTN recipient,
it will be reported on uploading to the IRP. So that is the issue. Offline tool errors will not be rectified at an immediate basis. While in API, it's in a real-time process, then you would have already developed some checks and it will automatically report it very fast to you. GSPs, the errors will be eliminated. So GSP generally have their own checks and balances, like we are doing currently GST1 through one of the GSPs. They have a lot of checks and balances, like the place of supply is incorrect, tax rate is incorrect. So many of the errors are reported at the first step only. We don't need to access the government portals and then find out the errors. So that can be the advantage of using the GSPs. So it's the comparison. It depends on what kind of a company is looking for. It's a very difficult decision because it involves a lot of cost and it is a decision that you need to take for the long run. So very informed decision has to be taken after evaluating all the factors. Now let us look at the e-commerce operators. As discussed, e-commerce operators have been given a separate registration into the IRP. So as we know, all these Amazons and Flipkarts, they generate invoices on the behalf of suppliers. If I go and buy anything on these e-commerce portals, I do get an invoice, but these invoices are in the name of the supplier. So it is like supplier is billing to me. E-commerce operator is just a media or via which this invoice is being generated. It is not who is billing to me. So there, those are requirements. So if there is a supplier whose turnover crosses 500 crores and he is also selling through e-commerce operator, how will it happen? So that is why government allowed them a special registration, which through which they can generate e-invoices as well. So they can, how will they get, so for currently, as you will know, all the e-commerce operators are required to collect a TCS on GST. And for this TCS collection, they have been already given a GSTIN, which is TCS based. So using the GSTIN, they can get themselves registered on the IRP portal. APIs have been made available. Once you get registered, then there are APIs which are available. So you are, so APIs that are available to e-commerce operator is, they can generate invoices for themselves or on behalf of the suppliers. For cancellation, they can do it for their own invoices and the invoices which have been generated on the, through their portal of the supplier. So if I'm a supplier and I am doing my, and I cross 500 crore turnovers, I might have supplies which are through e-commerce operator and through direct. So whatever direct invoices I am doing or directly accessing the APIs, those invoices or those IRNs will not be available to the e-commerce operator. It has been, the data security has been taken care of. E-commerce operator cannot cancel or dare not do anything with the invoices that I do or through direct linking. But if there are any invoices which are generated through e-commerce operator will have the right to cancel them and do anything with them. So as they can generate e-way bill on behalf of us, they can cancel those e-way bills if they have generated. Applicable, they can do get IRNs only for what they have generated on the behalf of the supplier. For registration in the sandbox e-commerce operator, as I told you, TCS, GSTN can be used. The JSON payload, the payload that e-commerce operators will be sending to the IRP will be quite similar what they are sending now, but just an additional feature of e-commerce GSTN will be added to the payload. Earlier, there were only two GSTN, seller and buyer GSTN. Now, third GSTN of e-commerce GSTN will also be added if it is being sent via e-commerce operator. So let us finally look at, so get more clarity, who will get access to the IRNs by the e-commerce operator and suppliers. When the IRNs are generated by the e-commerce operator, supplier also has the access to it. So if there is an IRN which is generated by the, let us say Amazon, even a supplier like me, if I will also get, I can cancel them, I can use them, I can get the details, I can do anything with that IRN that it is generated on my behalf. If I do anything directly, e-commerce operator does not have any control on it. IRN cancelled, e-commerce operator will have those details. If it is generated through e-commerce operator, both of us will have the details, supplier as well as the e-commerce operator. If these are cancelled by the supplier, only supplier can fetch those details. E-way bill generation, both of them will have the detail. If e-commerce operator, if any invoice has been generated by e-commerce operator, they can generate the EVA bill. Even a supplier can generate the EVA bill using that IRA. Finally, let us, so many of our clients may not have e-invoice applicable onto them, but they will have suppliers, they are procuring from suppliers who have e-invoice applicable to them. What precautions should a recipient take? Because as per law, any invoice by a supplier whose turnover crosses 500 crore will be an invalid invoice if it is not an invoice. And my credit may be denied by the taxpayer that this is not a valid invoice. So we have to be careful and take our own precautions. First and foremost, what we can do is if we know that there are certain big taxpayers or there is only a limited number of suppliers, we can use this link that we are showing, e-invoice one trial, where if you punch in the GSTN detail, you will be able to know whether e-invoicing has been made applicable to them. But as you know, this is not a foolproof plan. For example, someone misreported their 3B turnover, and so still e-invoicing will be applicable to them. So, but this is a good way to find out on an online mode without disturbing anything. At least have a 80-90% chances you will be able to find out ki whether invoicing is applicable and you can take the requisite actions. Secondly, what we are advising the clients is to take an declaration from the supplier ki whether they are invoicing is applicable. And also in the declaration, we put an indemnification clause ki bhai if any invoicing error that they have created on if it is applicable, then this tax liability will fall onto them and not to us. So that in future, if we have made them payment, we can go back and the credit is denied on this premise that it is not a valid invoice. We can always track down the supplier and ask for us the payment. The third that we should be careful of, third, if we get an verified invoice, we can always upload it to the JSON file. Upload a JSON file on the IRP portal. If we upload it, it will check whether this is correct, whether this has been signed by the IRP or not, or this is just an error. Then lastly, the government has also given an app to verify. So you put in your mobile number, if it's an Android phone or iOS phone, you will get an app, a link to the mobile app, and you can download this mobile app. For iOS, the app is not yet active. For the Android, the app is active and you can download it. So you put in your mobile number, you will get, give the OTP and you will get the link to the portal, link to this app. And on this app, you will be able to verify, so if you get a printed invoice from your supplier, you can always verify using the QR code. You can scan the QR code. If it is valid, it is showing the details. It is a valid invoice. Secondly, if you receive a JSON, you can always push, use the verify signed invoice. If you upload the JSON, it will show to the recipient whether this is a valid invoice or this is a wrong invoice. So these are the different precautions that a purchaser can keep in mind, although it is not applicable to them, but for future, rather than credit being denied, we can always be cautious. I think that is it from our side. Thank you for the patient hearing. Now we are open for any questions. You can either put it in the chat box or you can ask by unmuting yourself.
Thank you, sir, for the wonderful and informative session. I request members if they have any questions to be asked to the respective speakers.
Thank you very much. You are able to hear me? Are you able to hear?
Yes.
Thank you very much. It was a very nice presentation. I have a small query. This is regarding hospitals and educational institutions. I mean, universities. They have turnover of more than 500 crores, but then when you see the GST applicable invoices for them, that will be hardly few invoices. Maybe you can even say about only 50 invoices, because in hospitals, they might have some scrap sales. In certain universities, they have these consultation charges and other things, okay? So do they also have to register in
go for this e-invoicing, because if you see the quantum of the invoice, see in universities, they only give receipts. They don't issue invoices to the students, right? So how do you go about such cases where the income?
So ma'am, it is just based on aggregate turnover. There is no volume that is defined key number of invoices. So if their aggregate turnover, which includes exempt supply, as Richa already informed. So if your aggregate turnover is above 500 crore, you will have to generate invoicing. As I discussed, you can always go for that bulk offline facility. Excel tool. It should be cost effective. And as you have limited number of invoices, you can always do it on a batch processing way. So I think that would be easier, but applicability is governed by the turnover, which is aggregate, including the exempt supply.
Okay, so there is no other go. They have to get registered under e-invoicing. But in case of such few invoices that they have, they will have to go for only for B2B, they will have to generate this IRN numbers, right? Not for the other ones.
Not for the other ones.
Suppose if there is a student who is making a payment to the university, they are given certain receipt. In those things, you don't need these IRN codes and other things, right?
No, ma'am, definitely not.
Okay, okay. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Any more questions from the members, please?
Yeah, can I go ahead?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Robert, what sort of implication this e-invoicing will have on, you know, like one of my client is on SAP. In fact, we implemented the SAP last year. Now, what happened is whenever there are changes, there are financial implications for changing those configurations.
Right.
So, I mean, do we not have a body like which takes up these matters with the government of India, that when you do some tweaking, it has got huge cost implication? This is the one part of it. The second part is that we have multiple the GST part of it and the income tax part of it, and record keeping and the procedural requirements sometimes clash with each other. Would it have any implication with respect to the record keeping from under the provisions of income tax? Is there any such complication that you foresee besides the technological part?
No, I believe e-invoicing will make the lives easier. So because once it's done all online, it would be more smooth for everyone. And because one-time cost will have to be incurred. But in the long run, this is the future. And internationally, many countries have already implemented it. India is running behind only. So if for 500 crore taxpayers, I don't think it will be such a huge burden. That's my feeling. We will get to know how much.
Yeah.
So because your applicability is always important. And if you do it, it will be very smooth, and this fake invoicing, everyone will be getting a lot of cases of fake invoicing recently. And at least in Delhi, there are so many notices that are being issued for this fake invoicing that even in the corona, so that's why I'm saying even due to corona, I don't see any 4C extensions for the 1st October date. Otherwise, all the extensions are coming. Income tax is postponed everything by six months. But maybe invoicing will still be made applicable because there is so much issue, so much wrong credit is being taken, that hopefully this will curb it, because GST 2B, which is being introduced, should help in that matter. Because abhi to 3B is like self-assessment. You take credit as your own wish.
Yes, you are. I mean, that is, in fact, I was attending a webinar on this faceless scrutiny, you know, where Mr. Girish Uja was there. And he started with the fact that we had a lot of Jaan Pehchaan, and this faceless scrutiny is going to kill up that Jaan Pehchaan. I still remember. Can I share? Do we have a time? Can I share one moment?
Yes, 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 sir. Yes, sir. Please, please.
I still remember, you know, when I entered the practice around 25 years back. Then, since we were new and, the people who come to you first are the people who know you the best. So he came to me, he wanted to sell the property or buy something. He said, I want an ITCC. So straight out from the institute with the legacy of honesty and lot of values imbibed into us by the institute. And at a very tender age, that India is a very honest country, XYZ, alpha, beta, gamma. So I used to spot the turban at that point of time. I'm basically a Sikh. So I saw a ITO who was, full beard, that complete beard and turban. I say, thank God I got a Sardar on my first day. And he started pestering me. Eventually, I was having some problem in, making the greasing part of it. I was not able to get the ITCC, and I told him, I said, sir, I'm not able to get it done. So he appointed a very learned advocate of Chandigarh, and eventually told me, he said, it costed me 2,000 rupees because he was asking for a bribe. So what has happened over the last 20 years, in fact, I was writing an article, I keep on writing on LinkedIn, that why India is not growing. You've rightly mentioned that these efforts, whether it is faceless or whether it is GST, sort of e-invoicing. I know a client, I will not name it, out of his 110 crore rupees of turnover, around 57 crore rupees is, just only for banking purposes. So I completely agree with you that I hope it is not getting recorded and I get some notice somewhere that who is that client. Yes, stop doing all
that. It is getting recorded already, but I don't know what notice.
It's okay. It's okay.
I'll not upload that part.
It's very good. That, the guys, the younger breed which is coming to practice now, have gotten into an area where the knowledge is the king. And I still remember you said the invoicing. My client had a plant in the cluster of Bajaj Auto. The Bajaj has only, I think, one or two boys in their account department. Because what they do is they generate a number. We have to code that number, raise the invoice. When we raise the invoice, gatekeeper does is he scans that number. In case the number matches that number, the invoice gets reconciled with the PO, rates and all that stuff. If everything is hunky-dory, it automatically gets into their system, into their ledgers. So besides the technological cost, which an entrepreneur will always get on to you, many paise deta, government ko bolo paise do, hame is tarah ki sunne ko baatein milti hain. हम नहीं देते पैसे, मोदी को बोलो पैसे भी तो साथ में दे. अब होता क्या है कि इसके साथ रिपोर्ट भी जनरेट होंगी. अब वो एसएपी आपको पता ही है, हर रिपोर्ट को जनरेट करने के पैसे लेते हैं.
बिल्कुल सर.
हाँ, तो वो थोड़ी सी एक इश्यू आती है. इजीनेस ऑफ, ये तो बहुत अच्छी चीज है.
इन द लॉन्ग रन सर कॉस्ट इफेक्टिव हो जाएगा ये. In the long run, cost effective हो जाएगा. ईवे बिल्स, जीएसटी. अब मतलब मैं तो सोच रहा हूँ, वी डू अ लॉट ऑफ कंप्लायंस फॉर कंपनीज. This is going to go away. Matlab, I have to change my business. So we do a compliance for a lot of companies. So we assist them in return filing and consultancy. All this compliance, once e-invoicing will get applicable, GSTR-1 will get auto-populated. 2B is getting auto-populated. You just have to take where will the R value addition will go away. So that in few years time, our practice will also evolve.
It has evolved over a period of time. In the last years that I have seen, I remember the TDS return used to be manual. We used to run, so it has evolved from that. But ये अच्छा है ना, इतनी सारी compliance करते हैं, client fees तो increase करता नहीं है, और fees कभी कम होती नहीं है.
Right. So there is a question from Mr. Dinesh sir. Sorry, let's take that question. So yeah. The question is whether we need to print QR code from the portal, sir, for the B2C invoices. The B2C invoices are not, their QR code will be self-generated from your IRP or the accounting softwares. It will not be given from the any IRP. IRP is only for B2B invoices. So this is your own, and it has to be printed on the invoice, and it has to be done by your own accounting or ERP software, and not from the portal. CK Shanbag, sir, this is a long question. Just let me do it. Sir, can you unmute yourself and ask the question so that we can all hear this question? Mr. Shanbag.
Shanbag, sir? Or else I'll read out what he has written. So he's asking that in the earlier presentation by Richa ma'am, she excluded TCS from the amount chargeable to GST, which is correct. But does the reverse apply, like TCS is not applicable on GST charge in the invoice as TCS is on receipt on sale of goods and not just the value of goods?
So one thing, GST from CBIC on this matter, CBIC has made it clear that TCS is not a tax, it's just a pass-through entry, and GST will not be applicable on TCS. That has been made clear. But CBDT has not clarified anything on this matter. So as a new TCS of 0.1% is also coming from 1st of October, the clarification, any clarification is still awaited. How will it be done? So for example, 1 lakh is the taxable value and 0.1, let us assume TCS of 1%, that is 1000, and GST of 18,000. So GST will be applicable on 1 lakh rupees and not on 1,01,000. But TCS, it's not clear, will it be applicable on 1 lakh or 1,18,000? I believe, my personal view is it should be on the gross, because that I have seen many companies doing it in the VAT regime, doing at the cross value. But this is still yet to be clarified. There is no right answer to this. But GST has been made clear, will not be applicable on TCS. And this is not a...
And the next part is with e-invoice and after generation of IRN, one cannot rectify a mistake later easily, hence the question.
Sir, so you cannot definitely do any rectification, you can only do cancellation. So that is there. So you have to take a decision, what do you want to do? It has to be a conscious call by the management, ki how do you want to do it? I would personally suggest TCS on the gross value. But again, your income tax consultant or whoever is doing income tax should be the ideal person to suggest the company so that the auditor does not create a problem or the tax auditor does not create a problem. So the company should take a written opinion and then take an informed decision on this.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Any more questions?
Just to add to this, Gauravji.
Right, sir.
There was a webinar by this East Delhi Chartered Accountant Study Group yesterday on this topic of TCS, which is coming into the implementation in case the sale exceeds 50 CR. They, in fact, I hold the view which you, because prior to the GST on service tax, whenever there was a service tax, we never used to include service tax while deducting the TDS. However, yesterday I was surprised because he said, and the quite senior chartered accountant, that the TCS has to be deducted on the gross value, which includes GST. So even I am perplexed, which you have rightly cleared out, that because I thought there is a clarification from the income tax, which you have rightly clarified that there is a there is a clarification from the GST wing, indirect taxes. But there is no such clarification. In fact, that's the knowledge. There is no such clarification from the CBDT side of it, which might make us compute the TCS when we are configuring our system on the gross value, which include the GST part of it.
Right. Ashikaji, I'll share the PPT. No problem. I'll share with the Sir Pankajji and then he can share it with everyone in the group.
Yes, sir. Any more questions from the members, please? I guess, sir, there are no more queries. So, but I've got good reviews in the chat box about.
Thank you so much, sir.
Session being so excellent and informative. So on behalf of Chamber Study Circle, I would like to thank you and Richa ma'am for joining us today and guiding us through e-invoicing. So we have a member from Chandigarh, Mr. Singh Saab. So I would request Mr. Gurvinder Singh sir to please offer a vote of thanks. Thank you, sir. Yes.
Thank you for giving me this opportunity. And you know, I was scrolling through the website of ICAI for this thing, and I noted this. And it's so wonderful to have such an exhaustive and you know, filled with the knowledge, the kind of presentation that both of you had given us. For me, it was quite knowledgeable, and I guess as it is for all the participants. Thank you very much, Gauravji and Richaji, for such a wonderful presentation, and thank you very much for taking the time out. And maybe you might have to invite with your family that, okay, my presentation is there on Sunday. So thank you very much, both of you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your kind words. I hope it was informative. Some added information was given, because e-invoicing is a very discussed topic. So we tried to cover a lot more things. Thank you for everyone for patient hearing, especially as sir said on a Sunday morning. Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, dear members, for joining in. We'll meet you soon.
Thank you. Yes. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Bye. Take care, sir. Stay safe.
Thank you. Good night. Good.